Good morning and welcome to Food for Thought. It's Friday, April 16th, 2021. Glad you could join me again this morning. Today we're continuing our devotional series in discussions on the parables of Jesus. And today our parable is the parable of the sheep and the goats, which is found in Matthew chapter 25, verses 31 to 46. So if you want to follow along with me, I'm going to be turning to a couple of different passages this morning. And I'll be looking at Matthew 7 as well in conjunction with this particular parable. So the setting for this discussion was that Jesus wanted to make a point with his hearers that it's not superficial righteousness that determines whether a person is in good stead with God or not. It's the condition of the heart. So as a backdrop to this parable, I think it's good for us to look back in Matthew at the mentality that Jesus wanted to bring forward in this parable in Matthew 25. But in Matthew chapter 7, there's a backdrop to this. In verses 18 to 23, Jesus says this. He says, a good tree cannot bear bad fruit, and a bad tree cannot bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Thus, by the fruit, you will recognize them. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, and in your name drive out demons, and your name perform many miracles? Then I will tell you plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. So in that particular statement, Jesus is saying that it's not just profession of faith in him that saves a person. And a lot of people like to say that you can separate the fruit of the Spirit from the power of the Spirit. They have the power of the Spirit in their lives, but don't display its fruit. Well, there's a lot to be said about this. And the truth is that you can't separate the fruit from the Spirit and the power of the Spirit. If it's genuinely of the Spirit, it will have certain characteristics. And while it's true in the Bible's teachings that we cannot earn our salvation by good works, it's clear that even the best behaved among men are not good enough to earn their way to justification and reconciliation with God. But sometimes all of this important doctrine can get taken out of context to mean that a person can become a follower of Jesus Christ and remain unchanged in the way that they carry themselves. Some people say, well, that's just the way I am. I'm just a hard person by nature. I find it difficult to be compassionate and difficult to care. I'm just gruff. That's just who I am, so you just have to realize that's how I'll always be. But in the case of a person becoming a true believer, when God saves a person, the work of the Holy Spirit changes the heart and correspondingly changes the way that person carries themselves. And how a person carries themselves is really how a person treats other people. We can't remain unchanged if we truly are believers in Christ. It's impossible. The Spirit of Christ will change and soften us. If there's no change in action, it's safe to say that the heart was never changed, because the heart's not in submission to the will of God. The Holy Spirit's presence in a true believer sweetens that person, not just sometimes, every time. And it sweetens a person to seek to do the will out of their Heavenly Father, out of love for Him. We're not saved by works, yet that person who is truly saved will change in the way that they practically carry out their daily activities. And you might say that practical living acts as a litmus test of the true state of the heart. Now, this isn't to say that a true believer in Christ does not make mistakes and doesn't need to learn and to grow and continue being conformed to the character of Christ, but a true believer who is born again in the Spirit, who is a new creation in Christ, is one whose actions reflect the inward change of the heart. And this is why Jesus tells this parable that I'm about to read. Religious activity without humble submission to God amounts to pride and fails to change a person. So Jesus tells this story about the end of the age, the final judgment, when he separates humanity at the judgment seat, based upon whether they truly believed and accepted him as their savior and sacrificed for their sins, or rejected him and tried to earn eternal life by their own efforts. So, reading from Matthew 25, 31 to 46, Jesus said this: "When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, he will sit on his glorious throne. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another, as a shepherd separates sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left, and then the king will say to those on his right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me.' Then the righteous will answer him, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, and or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you as a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothing and clothe you? When did we see you sick and or in prison and go and visit you?' The king will reply, 'Truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me.' Then he will say to those on his left, 'Depart from me, you who are cursed, into eternal fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not invite me in. I needed clothes, and you did not clothe me. I was sick and in prison, and you did not look after me.' They will also answer, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or needing clothes or sick or in prison and did not help you?' He will reply, 'Truly I tell you, whenever you did not do for the one of the least of these, you did not do for me.' And then they will go away to eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life." You know, this is a sad parable. It's very sad because some people, it appears, look at Christianity as a system of living for self-help. And at the end of the age, there's going to be some professing believers who will be very surprised to find out that they never truly believed in and were never truly saved. It seems as though some who profess to know Jesus never actually took the gospel of Christ to heart. They looked at Christianity as merely a system of managing their own affairs and self-help for themselves, for their lives, to make things better for themselves. And, you know, it's apparent that people go to church for various reasons. And some people go to church and think that they're a child of God simply because they attend church and they claim to have an affinity towards Christ. They claim him as their savior. But it never really translates into their heart. The true nature of a heart that is changed by the Spirit of God takes on the attitudes accompanying. And those attitudes are not self-centered. They're not about me and about how to make my life better. But they're other-centered. You know, there is an after-effect of a truly changed heart that does help us in our lives. But that is not the motivating factor. The scripture that Jesus tells us in Matthew 16:24-26 actually brings this to light also, just like that earlier passage in Matthew that I read. Then Jesus told his disciples, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it." What am I trying to say here? The mark of the true believer is one of submission to the will of the Father. Concerning a changed heart of the true believer, Philippians chapter 2 tells us this in verses 1 to 7. It says, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any fellowship with the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider yourselves others better than yourselves. Each of you should look not only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking on the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. Friends, this is such an important question. You see, in that parable that Jesus told us, there's going to be some people that reach the end of their lives and they're before the judgment seat of God, and they find out that they were not truly believers in the Lord, even though they professed him. If a person hears the gospel but does not heed the call to the submission to the lordship of Christ over them, that person's pride in their own self-righteousness is like that of the Pharisees. And what they think will save them in their own righteousness will not. The tree of their lives will remain unregenerated, and correspondingly, they will not bear the fruit of righteousness, but they will bear the fruit of selfishness. By a tree and its fruit, you shall know them. A true believer displays good fruit, filled with compassion for others. The fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, all that stuff that, you know, the Scriptures talk to us about, that those elements of the fruit of the Spirit need to be hanging from the branches of our life if we're true believers. If they're not, we need to seek God and ask him, do I truly believe, Lord? In Romans 8:9, we're told this, those controlled by the flesh cannot please God. You, however, are not controlled by the flesh, but by the Spirit, if the Spirit of Christ lives in you, if the Spirit of God lives in you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to Christ. Well, what makes the difference between whether someone in the end is God's sheep or a goat? It's not the label that they identify themselves with. And that's not the determination whether they are believers or not. It's the Spirit of Christ, the Holy Spirit, living within them. If the Holy Spirit lives within a person, their actions will reflect the heart change, and they will be Christ-like, and they will be other-centered, thinking about the good of others. See, all these things that Jesus said, you know, the believers, out of the natural propensity for them to live out their lives in the Spirit of Christ, will have compassion upon others. They'll see others' need, and they're going to walk by and see the person who's been robbed and beaten and left for dead, and they're going to load him on the ride, take him to the inn, take care of them. You see, religiousness does not save a person. This is what Jesus is saying. It's God. It's the Spirit of Christ. It's humbling ourselves before him and saying, Lord, I need you. I can't do this on my own. I need to be saved by your grace. And then allowing that grace, freedom in us to change us. Yeah, you know, that's something that we can't force upon ourselves. This is a gift of God. It's not a work. It's not by works, lest anyone should boast, but it is a genuine bowing of the knee of the heart to the Spirit of Christ and humbling ourselves before it. And that's the hallmark of a true believer. See, Jesus tells us that not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of the Heavenly Father. There's much to say about this. I could speak another 5 messages on this topic alone. But I think if we look at the Scriptures and we see what Jesus is trying to say there, that there's some sober thought in this. And I pray that we would evaluate where our hearts are before God. If you're a person who's branded as a Christian, but you've never submitted to Christ, you've never really actually believed. You need to submit yourself to His Lordship over your life and be willing to follow Him and open your heart up to Him to being changed. And let go of the bottom. You can't save yourself. That kind of righteousness is legalistic and pharisaical. And that kind of religious behavior will leave you as a goat in the end when it comes to the judgment seat where Christ is judging the nations. This is food for thought.